All right, grab your Bible and turn to, obviously, Proverbs 17, verse 6. This is our seventh and final night of the Father Factor, and we'll be finishing that up next Wednesday night. We will be starting the Song of Solomon. If you want to read ahead, catch up, do whatever you can, and if not, just I'll explain it all over the next however many weeks. So how this is going to work, we'll finish up tonight. We'll start the Song of Solomon, which will get us close to the summer. In the summer, I'm going to do a Corey Coffin conspiracy about a few weeks on vibrations and frequencies and stuff like that. I'm going to start showing you some cool stuff out of your Bible. And so that'll be pretty much our lineup and take us into the school year, or the next year's school. So Father Factor is where we're at. We're on the final one. We're talking about the impact of a dad. You talk about having, when people say somebody has daddy issues, this is literally it. I've literally tried to do my best to break down where those quote-unquote daddy issues come from. And, it's bottom line is God has given us an innate desire to be connected to our Father in a way that we're not connected to any other human, including our own mother. And so Proverbs 17:6, children's children are the crown of old men. And the glory of children are their fathers. In other words, what a kid wants to worship is his dad, and we've explained that. And the reason God gave that innate desire was because, fathers, we were only designed to be a picture to point them to the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the relationship they were going to have throughout their lifetime with him. And if we do our job right, then it's a smooth transition from them as children into adulthood and being able to understand, oh, I get this relationship with God. I had that same relationship with my earthly father. And so hopefully we can do a good job at that. So tonight, we're going to talk about the seven biblical responsibilities of a father. Now, if you spend enough time around here, God works in sevens, man. I mean, it's exhausting sometimes talking about all the sevens that God works in. That's why you'll never get me to buy into that 3.5-year trib thing. That's not how God works. He works in sevens. And if you're going to tell me the first 3.5 years of that trib was Jesus' ministry, I'm going to ask you to show me that in the book of Revelation and lay that out for me. And I've heard all the stories. But either way, sevens. God works in sevens. Men, we, as husbands, we have seven biblical responsibilities as husband. Ladies, you have seven biblical responsibilities as a wife. And so now here we are tonight, we're coming to find out as fathers, we have seven biblical responsibilities to our kids. Now you may be thinking, okay, well, what are the responsibilities of a mom? Well, that's easy. To do whatever her husband tells her to do. Some people think that's funny, others don't, all right? Now, bottom line is obviously moms are a huge impact. I've never studied it out. I dare say there's probably seven if you break it down, just because the way God works in patterns throughout the scripture. However, we're going to talk about the seven biblical responsibilities of a father, and I think this is a great place to go to stop the series or end the series because it kind of helps us. Now, tonight, you're not going to figure out how to get over your dad issues, but what you are going to be able to do is, especially if you are a father, to understand that you have seven biblical responsibilities that God gave us to make sure that we develop our kids in such a way that once they get older, they will understand. And by the way, if we have seven biblical responsibilities as an earthly father, what do you think the chances are that those seven same biblical responsibilities is what they'll find as adults in the Heavenly Father? I mean, that's, as overall, we're here to be a picture. So, we're going to start with number one, protecting your children, all right? Now, this one seems pretty basic, right? Like, what guy on the planet doesn't understand protecting his kids? Like, seriously, if I can walk around and slap your kid around in front of you and you go, hey, you shouldn't do that, there's something really wrong with you, right? Like you don't have to take classes. You don't have to have somebody teach you a certain way to understand. It is basic, simple understanding of protecting your kids. Okay, I'm that way. You can say a lot of trash about me, and as a pastor, I know. Trust me, I know how this works. The pastors catch a lot of that. You know, I can't believe you'd say that, and I don't know why he thinks that way. And you know, I get it. And I'm cool with all that. And you can talk trash about me all day long. I'll probably just smile at you and talk trash back. However, you talk trash about my kids or my wife, I'm coming at you. I mean, it's just a natural, innate desire to want to protect. Don't come after my family. Come after me. Okay? I think most men in here would go, yeah, I get it. That's easy to understand, right? Okay. Now, we're going to talk about that. Now, we get over here, and I want you to understand that the way God breaks this thing down in kind of some umbrella type ways, and this is one of the reasons, ladies, you need to understand how God set up the structure of the home. It is not a way of keeping you down. I don't care what the feminists say or what the world says. The way this works is children are under the umbrella of that mother, and that mother is under the umbrella of the husband, and therefore that husband is over that household. Now understand, he's not the supreme ruler, is he? There's an umbrella over the top of him, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. And if when we are walking in the Spirit of God, in obedience to God's word, those umbrellas are the protections that God has laid out. That's one of the reasons why I'm really big with young people when they're bringing in children into this world. And whew, man, it's a lot of pressure. And you think it's tough now, just wait until they're older. All right? It gets more, okay? And what you need to understand is when you, especially dads, get outside of the umbrella of God's protection, you're endangering your whole family. Moms, when you decide, hey, I know better, I'm going to step outside of the umbrella of my husband, you're endangering your whole family. And kids, that's basically simple. When a child gets outside the umbrella of obeying their parents, all this breaks down, okay? And the reason God has structurally put it together is so that we can really protect the family. And you're going to understand what protection is in just a second. You know, obviously, I think most of us understand if you go up here to the Walmart, I don't go, but if you do, it's my job to protect my family. If a guy breaks into our home tonight, it's not my job to go, hey, go see what that was, okay? It's my job to go do that, right? Now, if I know that it isn't somebody breaking in, I'm pretty sure I'm going to be like, what was that? Go check it out. All right? So, you know, but either way, we have a structural plan that God has laid out. Now, so when we think of protecting our children, we're going to start with physically. We are to do that. And I'm going to take you over here to Matthew chapter 12, verse 29. And I understand, doctrinally speaking, the chapter 12 of Matthew is where we get the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit. And guys, I know you've heard a lot of stuff about it, and I'm not here tonight to break down that scripture, but it is essentially the leaders of Israel attributing the power in which Jesus was working to the devil or Beelzebub. Okay? And that is, the nation basically rejected Christ and attributed all that he was doing to that of the power of the devil. And basically, that's, in a nutshell, what that is. But Jesus speaks a truth in here that is doctrinally applied to their situation, but we can inspirationally or devotionally apply it to our life, and that is simply this, okay? Listen, he said, or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he first bind the strong man and then he will spoil his house? In other words, it's basic common sense. If a guy wants to break into my home, he knows I've got to deal with the strong man. I got to deal with Corey first. I get him tied up and get him bound. And if you're listening to the words I'm using, you understand where I'm going. If I can get him bound up, then I can spoil his home. I can go after and grab everything I want to do. I can take my time, load my van, and drive off with his stuff. Okay? Now, gentlemen, if you looked at the value of your home's items, your wife and kids is going to be at the top. I don't care what else you own. Fire breaks out. If I can get them out, we'll replace everything else. And the reason why we know that is because at the end of this world, at the end of life, and I don't care what you look at or what you can point at, the only two things that are going to last forever is the Word of God and the souls of men. Everything else is just going away anyway. According to Peter, it's all going to burn up. So, but isn't it interesting that we spend most of our life working hard to get all this stuff? And what we actually do is sacrifice those souls that are in our home to get all that stuff. And yet, the most valuable, precious thing, a soul means so much to God, He sent His Son to this earth to die for it. I mean, imagine what that soul's valued at. And yet, the way Mark would put it is, God has given us all this stuff as resources so that we can invest in souls of men with the Word of God. That's what your job's for. That's what the house is for. That's what all the stuff's for. But we spend so much time sacrificing the souls of men in the Word of God to get the resources. We got it backwards. That's why churches, I have a problem with this. We think the successful church is a lot of people in a building. And what we do is we use men to build ministries. And God intended for us to take ministry and build men. Which means you can't tell me how successful a church is based on its size. I got to know how quality are the people in it. That's what we're working on. That's the product, the people, not the buildings. All right? Now, so bottom line is most of us understand that I'm going to be the physical protection to my family. Now, that's the easy part. Let's talk about spiritually. Now, most men in here have no problems comprehending what it means to get in the battle and protect your family physically. Like, you come at my family and I'm coming with everything I got. Yet every single day, your wife and your kids get up and get bombarded with fiery darts of Satan. And many times us dads are so oblivious to it, we don't even know to protect. And yet we go about our day not spending much time praying and asking God to protect them. And one of the most scariest thoughts to me, whether it's physically or spiritually, is I can't be with you all the time. I just can't. I've got to go do this thing called a job so we can have our money and our food and our clothing and all that. And so there's going to be times that you're away from me and I can't protect you. And more scarier thought is most of the advances to hurt you has nothing to do with physicality. It's spiritually. And what I realize is our opponent is far greater than we are. That's scary. We're up against an enemy we can't even see. That'll rock you, man, when you start to realize it. Ephesians says it this way. Ephesians 6, 11 and 12 says, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Then he says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. How many people have ever been broken into in the middle of the night and you had to pull out your gun? All right. I'm going to have to hear that story, all right? All right. Well, I wasn't expecting that, all right? The vast majority of us didn't, all right? But here's what I can tell you. Every single home represented in here that wants to live for God, you're going to wrestle against an entity that's not flesh and blood. And that's why he says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, and against rulers of darkness of this world. Not some next dimension, right here where you and I are at. And he goes on, he says, spiritual wickedness in high places. And your greatest value, men, is your kids. And Satan wants them more than you realize. And he's going to do everything and he's going to work everything in his favor to get them. Whether that's making sure they don't get saved, or if they are saved, making sure they become an absolute failure for God. But that he is coming for them for sure. And it's easy to think, I will protect you physically. That part's easy. The spiritual side's the heart. He goes on in verse 16, above all, taking the shield of faith wherewith you are able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. That's that whole umbrella thing. That's that protection that's around us, because he knows, God knows, Satan's coming for him. The Bible says here in Peter, he says, be sober, be vigilant. Do you know what? Now, the word sober here is not necessarily attributed to alcohol. This word is clear-minded. Man, making sure you realize what's going on. And in a world of devices and games and internet issues, as a parent, as a father, you don't get to just sit on the sidelines and go, yeah, I really don't know what's going on in this world. You better. Because all that stuff, 2 Corinthians 4:4 says that the God of this world has designed it to blind the eyes of them that don't know the Lord. And not only that, he's coming after our kids who may be saved, but he wants to attack them. And yet here he says, be sober. And then he says, be vigilant. I could do a whole thing on Charles Bronson here with the vigilante to tell you how old I am. Now the bottom line is that you're on guard, you're on alert, you know he's coming. Now, let me ask you something. If you had somebody call you and said, hey man, I was talking to a guy today and he was talking to this dude and they're breaking into your house tonight, would you just go, okay. No, you'd sit up with the shotgun in your hand.
Home alone.
Yeah, they ain't coming home with me, all right? Now, he says, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. Okay, now how many of y'all would go on a safari and park it right there in the African Sahara and go, all right, kids, get out and play? Not one of us, right? I've seen these safaris that they got the cages over them and the lions are attacking the cage, and I'm thinking, you guys are messed up, right? But we wouldn't let our kids just go, oh, isn't he cute? Go out and pet him. Yet we do it every day. Every day, spiritually, we send our kids out into this world and go, be careful. And just let them go about. And here's the thing. You said, well, I'm always watching my kids. Are you? The access to what they have in my hand. Listen, I grew up in the greatest decade ever. I grew up in the 80s. And I am so glad I'm older than Google, right? I grew up before the internet. There wasn't all that. Video games had just gotten started, but you know, most parents weren't rich enough for every kid to have one, and maybe one kid in the neighborhood might. And you know, we spend most of our time out playing and doing our thing. And Satan has made it convenient for the temptations to these kids to come right to the palm of their hand. And yet you go, hey, I check my kid's phone. Okay, well, hang on, Skippy. You think you're deeper in those computers than your kids are? Man, they know a lot more stuff about that than we do. And Satan is working his way to make sure he can get to them any way he can. And boy, you talk about protection. It is hard to protect against an enemy. You cannot only not see him, but if you're not sober and vigilant, you don't even know that he's around. These lions can be lurking in the weeds and you don't even know they're there. And yet, boom! 9 in 10 boys and 6 in 10 girls will be exposed to pornography before the age of 18. You understand, that's 90% of males. That's a lot. 6 in 10 girls, that's 60% of girls involved in pornography, getting to see it. You know how? You said, well, how'd that happen? Because we now have 10-year-olds with these. And then this is not one of these sermons that they used to do back in the day. You ought to burn your phone, you know, all that stuff. No, I'm not saying to do any of that. What I'm saying is, as dads, we get this responsibility to oversee and watch and look and try to find where the enemy's coming. Now, yeah, flip phone. I'm wanting one of those. Look at this. 10% of 12 to 13-year-old fear they are addicted. 44% of the boys say to give them the idea of what is out there. That, in other words, that's the only reason they went to church. I just want to see what's out there. And by the way, that's how Satan works. Yeah. Satan never works in his true disguise or his true view. He's always disguised it somehow. 39, watch this. 39% of girls think it's realistic depiction of real sex. Now, for those of you that think this is just a guy thing, you got to wake up. The girls of today are as vulgar as the boys ever were. We just heard this stat the other day. The average 23-year-old girl has the same number of sexual partners as the average 53-year-old woman. And she's 23. Right? It all started with this whole thing. And remember, it started in the 60s with the sexual revolution. Anytime the world gets a revolution, it just gets weird. Gets worse. Right? Now, I'm going somewhere. It affects the brain, and I'm going to show you something in just a second. But I'm trying to give you this thing about protection, and I know we're spending a lot of time on this first one, but man, I cannot emphasize to you enough the danger as men, as fathers, and we're sitting on the sidelines, more worried about who won the Super Bowl, and okay, what March Madness is coming up, and we're all, hey, wait about, it's hunting season, we're doing all this stuff, and yet, Satan is like, yeah, I'm at work. Why, you're oblivious. Researchers have found that internet porn and addictive substances like tobacco have the same similar effect on the brain. Like other addictions, porn attracts the part of the brain called the reward center. So it triggers dopamine in the brain. The problem is the more you do it, the more dopamine you need to get the same high, just like every other drug. That's where the addiction comes in. I won't spend the time on reading all that. Here is a healthy brain. This is an addict's brain. Okay, pay attention here. Now, this is called a SPEC scan. Okay, this is what a healthy brain would look like. Okay, then you have these pits or these areas that look like holes. This is a heroin brain. This is a brain on porn. Check out this brain scan. It's called a SPEC scan. It's rather telling. The holes in the brain aren't actually holes, but they are the places in the brain that lack blood flow. Now, once again, we could have a conversation about adult people doing this. That's a whole different argument than what I'm trying to make tonight. Kids in developmental years who brains are not fully developed completely yet because they're children. And yet this is what's going on. And once again, this is not just, hey, let me deal with pornography tonight. We could deal with a plethora of things out there. I'm just showing you one area of spiritual attacks that Satan is using. Satan is designing this so that kids get a misunderstanding of what intimacy is. And now that they're adults, they can no longer connect intimately with somebody through intimacy, because what they are connecting with sexual issues is what they saw in pornography. And not only what they saw, but how it affects the brain. And man, it's if we had more time, I'd go over the rest of it. Job, you ever notice Job? Job's kids were, you know, doing their thing. They're out of the home, right? You know what Job's doing? Going and making sacrifice for him. And the reason being is because, dads, if you're here today and you go, well, wait a minute, my kids are grown. Well, congratulations. That doesn't mean your job's done. Doesn't mean your responsibilities are over. Here's a guy who is still looking after the spiritual integrity of his kids even as they're grown, all right? Now, number two, teach your children. I got to get rolling, man. I just took 25 minutes to talk about protecting your children. All right, now teach your children. Now, we're going to start with number one, the personal responsibility of teaching. I want you to see a few verses here. And I'm going to keep coming back to this verse tonight, but I want you to notice here. All right? And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now, the word nurture here, we think of a mom going, oh, poor little Bobby, you know, he broke his little finger or whatever. Okay, nurturing with a woman is one thing, but that's not what the verse is saying for us. And he's speaking to fathers specifically. Nurture is the word to tutorage or to teach, all right? That's to educate or to train, okay? Then the word admonition, which where we get our word admonishing, all right, is a mild rebuke and warning. And he's saying, fathers, your job is to teach your kids right and wrong. And when they are wrong, it is your job to admonish them. In other words, rebuke them and warn them and explain, hey, man, that's wrong. You shouldn't do that. And hang with me. We're talking about teaching here. 1 Thessalonians 2:11. Now, I'm going to go to this verse three times tonight, but right now I want you to notice. He says, and you know how I exhorted you, we'll talk about that later, and comforted you and charged you, every one of you, as a father doeth his child. The word charge here, okay? Every time somebody gets married that I am doing the services, when that bride and groom come up and stand there and they're wanting to do all that sweet, you know, stuff that they come up with, before they get to do any of that, they got to stand there publicly and get chewed out by me. And it is my way of publicly charging them to do right, act right, and basically instill into them what their jobs are. It's my job as a pastor. Listen, when we ordained Justin, Brett preached the charge. And he's charging him of his duties. And the purpose of that is when he doesn't do those duties, we can go and say, hey, you knew what your job was. We publicly told you what that was. Same thing with the child. Now, Deuteronomy 6:6-9. Now pay attention to that. And these words which I command you this day shall be, where should they be? And now he's talking to the fathers. The word of God has to start where? Not in your head. Who cares as a dad that you can answer all the Bible trivia games? That's awesome. Cool. Meanwhile, God's saying, I want this book in your heart. Now pay attention. Here's why. Thou shalt teach them diligently to thy children. Now, he's talking to the fathers. Right now, as I speak over here in this room and upstairs, is Awana, and it's great. And Drew and Whitney and the whole crew, that's awesome. I am so thankful that we have help like that. Come in here on Sunday. We're going to divide your kids up, and they're going to go sit under Kathy and Cheryl and Steve, and some of them may even make it to my class and Rodney's class and so forth. And that's awesome. We're going to do our best to teach. And then we're going to walk them in over here. And many of them of older age are going to sit in and listen to Justin do a Sunday morning service. And that's great. But it's not my job to teach your kids. I am here to help you teach your kids. But it's not my job for you to instill it into your kids' hearts. That responsibility is yours, Dad. You're the one to teach your kids. We, for some reason, we got the idea that, well, my wife's going to teach the kids the Word of God, and I'll teach them about hunting and fishing. Where did you get that? It's not your wife's job to teach them the Bible. She can help with it. It's not her responsibility. And watch. Okay. Shall talk of them when thou sittest in thine house. He says, when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. In other words, everywhere you go, the book should be prevalent. The kids should be able to look at dad and go, man, that dude's always talking about the Word of God. He's always wanting to instruct us about what God's doing. He says, and thou shalt bind them for a sign on the hand. CJ was doing a study on the Old Testament, colors and different things of the old priesthood, and he taught that Sunday, and right before that, me and him were going over some things, and about 15, 20 years ago, I was doing a study on the Ten Commandments, and everybody's got it in their head that they were granite, right? Like he broke these granite plates. They were actually sapphire, which is the color blue. When you study in the Word of God, blue represents the Word of God. Now, he's telling you, I want you to bind them for a sign on the hand. They had this string they wrapped around their hand. You know what color it was? Blue, to remind them of the Word of God. There should be stuff in our minds constantly reminding us of this book. He says, why? And they shall be in thy frontlets, right up in front of you, between your eyes. Thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and upon thy gates. In other words, everywhere you go. He's talking to you, dads. He's not talking to your wife. He's not talking to grandma. He's talking to fathers. Now watch. So not only do we have a personal responsibility, but let's look at the purpose of teaching, okay? Now I'm going to show you these two things, and I want you to pay quick attention here. Two times in the Old Testament, God says, I'm giving you this for a memorial. One of them is the Passover. And he says, you guys know the story. They're in Egypt, which is a picture of the world, and they are bound by their taskmasters, which is a picture of the sin nature in our life, and that in order to get freedom from Egypt in the world and the freedom of sin, they needed to be covered by the Passover lamb, by the blood on the doorpost, right? And so God delivers them out of there. Soon as they get over to the other side, God tells them, hey, you're going to make a memorial of this day all the time, every year. Why are you going to do that? Here's what he says. And it shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, your children say unto who? The Father. I ain't to watch. What mean ye by this service? What's up with this Passover thing? Well, son, I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you about that. We were over here in Egypt. We were bound. And our taskmasters had control of us. And God took the Passover lamb, the blood of the lamb, and washed it on our doorpost. And we were underneath that blood. And so the death angel went across and he delivered us from that bondage. In other words, son, we were in debt to God. We were in bondage to sin. And Jesus Christ, the Passover lamb, came and died and gave his life and covered us. Right? That's what that's all about. Now hang with me. There's one other one, what I call the crossover. So they get there to the land 40 years later. Oh, good night. 40 years later they get there, which should have been an 11-day journey. 40 years later they get there and the Jordan's in front of them. And God says, here's what we're going to do. We're going to bring the ark, which is a representation of Christ, leading the people in. And as soon as he stepped into the water, the priest did, with the ark, boom, the waters were stopped. They walked over. And God says, hey, I need you to pick up some of these big stones that's in this dry riverbed right now while the water's being held back, because I'm going to have a pile of stones over here. Well, why are you going to have a pile of stones, God? Here's what he says. That this may be a sign among you that when your children ask who? Their fathers. In the time to come, saying, what mean ye these stones? Okay, now, what's this Passover mean? Oh, it's a picture of us getting saved. Okay? What's up with these stones? That's a picture of us entering into the promised land. Okay, which if you understand the teaching of this church, The Passover is a picture of you coming out of Egypt, is a picture of you being saved. But entering into Canaan is not, has nothing to do with heaven. Entering into Canaan is you living the Spirit-filled life right here, right now. Okay, watch this. The vast majority of kids in 2024 who grow up in church, they understand a dad who has been saved, who's been relinquished from the bondage of sin, who's been covered by the blood of the Lamb. They get that. But very few kids growing up in church ever understand what these stones are about. Having a dad who has entered in to the Spirit-filled life, who is living life to the fullness and the abundance of in Christ. Very, very few kids see that. And when there is a disconnect between, yeah, I've been saved, to, yeah, I'm not doing all that I need to do for Jesus, it affects them. And God intended you, Dad, to be able to give them the story of how you got saved and then to turn around and go, yeah, but that ain't the end of the story. Let me tell you how we enter into the Spirit filled, walking in the Spirit life. And I'm not talking about some Pentecostal goofiness. I'm talking about what it means to walk with Jesus Christ and gain victory over sin in our life. All right, now, so not only teach your kid, but lead your children, okay? Now, lead. I'm going to do something they did for me in school. A farmer is one who farms. Isn't that cool? Yeah. A painter is one who paints. A leader is one who leads, right? This is not tough. The actual essence of being a leader is somebody's following you. If you go to work tomorrow and you're just driving down the road, you're not leading anybody. You're just going along with the crowd. But if you get in your car and you go, hey, follow me, and you're going, you look back, yeah, I'm the leader here. Dads, if your kids aren't following you, you're not a leader. You're not their leader. And I appreciate the opportunity to be a pastor in this church. I really do. I don't take that lightly. And I know that a lot of people in this church look to me, look to Justin and Jerry for spiritual leadership, and that's great. Dad, that's your job, to be the leader. Your kids should look at you and go, hey, whatever my dad's doing, that's what I want to be doing. Here's what it said. Now, I want you to pay attention here. This is a guy named David Bednar. He made this statement. He says, an answer we discover or obtained through the exercise of faith is typically retained for life. And here's what he says. The most important learnings of our life, listen to this, are caught and not taught. Okay? No. Hang to that thought. In other words, kids have this knack of doing exactly what you do even when you don't open your mouth. And they have this idea to go, oh yeah, I know you're saying this, but I'm watching you do that. And what they're catching is what we're doing, not what we're saying. Now, I'm going somewhere. Watch. Deuteronomy 11, back here. He says, therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and in your soul. Now, this is not the same verse I read earlier. This is about five chapters later. And he says, listen, take these words, put them in your heart. Do you think your kids actually know whether that book is in your heart? They know more than you and I can even begin to understand about us. They study us. And they know whether it's just talk or whether it's here. Okay, now watch. He says, and bind them for a sign upon your hand that ye may be on the frontlets of your eyes. Ye shall teach them your children, speaking of them. All right, now watch this. Notice before you start to speak and teach with your kids, where's the book got to be? In your heart. We have a lot of dads running the mouth. They'll come to church. They'll say all the right things. They'll even speak Bible. But man, these kids know that's not here. That's here. And God's saying, no. You want to lead your children? Lead them. Listen, I can tell you where to go, right? I can right now tell you how to get to the big chicken. It's a whole lot easier if you just follow me to the big chicken. Right? I can tell you how to get there, but isn't it easier if you just follow me? I can tell you how to get to my shop. I can tell you how to get to a lot of places, but it's a whole lot easier if you just get in your car and follow me. And that's what God wants with fathers and children. Follow them. Lead them. Okay? Now watch. 1 Timothy 3:4 and 5, one that ruleth well his house. Remember, we just talked about this 2 weeks ago. When we go to hire a pastor, the Bible tells us to look at the kids. And it's not just, well, you know, Justin's got little kids, and so his kids need to be in subjection. No, he doesn't give an age limit. He says on there, he says, for if a man, he said, listen, their children need to be in subjection with all gravity. Subjection to who? The father or the father? Yes. Okay, now watch this. For if a man knoweth not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Now, let me, since we're talking about leadership, if I can't lead four people in the Gordon household to serve the Lord, what's the chances I can lead you as a congregation to serve the Lord? Like, my chances aren't going to be that great. I mean, if my own son goes, yeah, I'm good. I don't need to hear your trash anymore. Well, why do you want to listen to me on a Sunday? My own son didn't want to hear it. And so God says, hey, man, you really need to check these dudes out. You want to know leadership? Like, you can read all the self-help books on leadership, but that's not leaders. Right? Now watch. I like what Ralph Waldo Emerson says. Your actions speak so loud, I can't hear what you say. Oh, I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. I was watching what you were doing. And that's exactly what kids do. Now, quickly, we got to move on. Discipline your children, all right? Now, the rest of them should fly, but, you know, this thing of discipline, right? Now, notice here, we get back here. He says, and you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now, this is where we get this admonishing. Okay? Nobody likes the discipline part, right? And I get it. There's probably people in this room that disagree with what I'm about to give you out of the book of Proverbs. That you think, well, we don't think like that anymore. Oh, we know. We can look outside and tell that society doesn't believe in discipline. And oh, by the way, just a little side note, do you honestly think we're in better shape as a society without the old school discipline? I mean, you don't even have to be that deep to realize, man, we got a society of weirdos. We had dinner Saturday night in St. Louis with multiple couples, but one of the ladies teaches middle school, and I was like, how do you do it? You know, and we're sitting here, she's like, the kids ain't that bad. It's the parents. The parents are the problem. Okay, now watch. Hebrews 12, 7 and 8 said, if you endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with a son. But what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then you are bastards and not sons. He's simply saying, if you are a child of God, God's going to discipline you like a good father does. If he doesn't discipline you, you're not a child of God. Which means if you can live like hell, and God's like, eh, that's cool. That's not a very good spot to be in. You talk about it. A security issue. Okay, now hang with me. Proverbs says foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. In other words, it's there when he was born. Foolishness is. But the rod of correction shall drive it. What's the it? The foolishness far from him. They come into this world jacked up. And I know every one of you go, oh, my kids were angels. I'm sure they were. Fallen angels. I mean, at the end of the day, when they come in, you can, okay, I've got a grandson who's just a little over a year, and you can already see defiance concerning our kitchen cabinets, right? And the bottom line is, no, you're not allowed in there. We run the show, you don't. Okay, now watch Proverbs 23:17-14. Withhold not correction from the child, for if thou beatest him with the rod, he shall not die. Thou shalt beatest him with a rod and shall deliver his soul from hell. Now, that almost sounds, can you imagine being on the Oprah show with that one? Like, man. Okay, now listen to me and please understand the spirit in which I'm saying. The verse is literally saying, beat the hell out of them. He's not talking about physically. He's saying inside is bound up inside this child is foolishness. And if you do not correct this, that child is on a pathway to hell. And my job is to keep you out of hell. At bare minimum, keep you out of jail. Like, you know, that's what my job is. Okay, now understand, he's like making sure discipline. Chasten thy son while there is hope. In other words, you know what that verse is implying? There's going to come a day then there is no hope. It's too late. I've counseled a lot of people in my time with parents and dealing with kids, and I'm like, it's too late. It's too late. He's grown. The product's done. Whatever it is now. Your only hope now is prayer. Let not thy soul, now notice thy soul. In other words, let not thy soul spare for his crying. I can just tell you as a dad who was a strong disciplinarian, first of all, we believed in the 0 to 5 issue. In other words, we did all the spanking from 0 to 5 years old because we felt like if I can get control of you by the time you're 5, my words is all I need to use after that. Okay? Now, when it says, let not thy soul spare, he's not talking about the kid's soul, he's talking about yours. If you're a dad and you get your kicks from discipline, you're wired wrong. Because a true biblical discipline stinks, man. It's a part of my job I don't want. I never wanted it. What I wanted was to just do right so I don't have to do this. Because this is horrible. And guys, some people will disagree with me. My wife was allowed to discipline in our house, but it wasn't her responsibility. It was my responsibility. I'm the dad. Now, that didn't mean it wasn't her response. You know, I mean, she's looking after her kids, but our kids' discipline came down to my job. Now, I used to tell them, beat the dog water. I mean, if that don't work, when I get home, I'll handle it. Right? Now, the other thing was, I had a real issue if my kids smarted off or talked back to their mom, especially after all that she does for them anyway. But my main thing was, ho, hold up, big boy. That's not your mom. That's my wife. And you're popping up on my wife right now. We're not handling that. Funniest day ever was the day CJ popped off to Christy and didn't know I was in the house. And if you've been to our house, I'm at my office desk looking down a hallway, and he was like, fine, I will. And I go, hey! And he elevates off the ground because I wanted my kids, and I wanted him to have that ideology of, hey, don't you talk to your mom like that. This is my job to be a disciplinarian. Now, Proverbs 13:24. He that spareth his rod hateth his son. Woo, those are some big words. For those of you that think, no, I love my kid, I could never discipline them. That's the opposite of love according to Scripture. Because if you love them, the worst thing that could ever happen to my kid is go to hell. Like, that's the worst thought in my mind. That's worse than even me going to hell. I can't fathom my kid going there. And so I'm like, no, I love you, and that's why I do this. All right? But he that loveth them chasteneth them many, or b times means many times. Verse 29:15, the rod and reproof give wisdom, but watch this, but a child left to himself bringeth his mother to shame. It's embarrassing when you get the phone call that your kid got arrested. It's embarrassing when the school has to call because your kid's out of line. It's going to be embarrassing when your kid's on television doing something stupid or on YouTube or wherever. Now, in today's world, I don't think the parents are embarrassed. I, for whatever reason, there's no shame coming. Correct thy son, and he shall give thee rest. Yea, he shall give thee delight unto thy soul. There's nothing more unrestful than having a kid that's wayward and out there, and you don't know what they're doing. All right. Number 5, exhort your children. All right. Now, I want you to notice that the word exhorting your children speaks of your presence. Now, pay attention. We talked about this verse earlier, okay? Now, he says, as you know, we exhorted, comfort, and charged you as a father doeth his children. Now, I want you to understand this word exhort, and I rarely ever give Greek words, but I'm going to do it just so you can see a connection, is parakleio, or however you say it, but it is a sister word to parakletos, where we get the word comforter, which is where we get our English word paralegal, okay? And the parakletos, the comforter, is the Holy Spirit. And the definition of the parakletos is called to one side. This word, being very connected to it, is the same thing. Called to be present. In other words, you got to be standing there. And so he says, if you're going to exhort your kids, you got to be there. You can't be at the hunting club or the golf course or the basketball game or working out in the yard all the time. You have to find time to spend with your kids. You got to be by their side, which includes work. There is a hard issue of having to determine how much work to put in to provide and how much time to take off to be present. And the bottom line is you got to be near him. John 16:7 is the comforter. He's called to your side. Number 6, comfort your children. So if comfort implies being present, comfort speaks about your words. Okay, let's go back to the verse. As ye know, we exhorted and comforted and charged you. So he's talking about the words that you speak to them. Okay? Words matter, whether we realize it or not. And sometimes dads come home, you're fired up, somebody at work's done torch you off, and all of a sudden kid says something, boom! And you just let it go. Or maybe it's not even that obvious. Maybe it's a little subtle. And you say something, and you don't think nothing about it, and 10 years later that kid goes, do you remember when you said that to me? And you're going, no. Right? Because the words matter. And what we're supposed to be using our words for is comfort. I'll give you a prime example. Do you know when Lazarus died, the friends came around to Martha and Mary, and they comforted them, meaning just words of comfort. Every time somebody dies, somebody's in the hospital, somebody's in a bad way, and I have to make a visit, whether that's people dying or whether Sal's father died here not long ago, and just making the phone call is rough for me because I'm like, I don't know what to say. I never feel like I have the words. And sometimes the comfort isn't just knowing how to say it just right. It's just, hey man, how you doing? It's letting that person know, I love you, I care for you, I want to be here for you. And when we do that for our kids, the words have different meanings to them. Now, and I'm closing right here, all right? Don't provoke your children, okay? So if we're going to do all these things. We're going to get to the last, and we're going to provoke our children. And you've seen me do this already, but I want to end with this, because this is the biggie. You have two verses, Ephesians, and you have Colossians. Ephesians and Colossians are sister books. One is us in Christ. The other one is Christ in us. And they are so connected. And in one, he talks about provoking them to anger. And here's what he says, Ephesians 6:4. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger or to wrath, which is anger. Like, ugh! People will always want to know why I was so intense and why I was always fired up. Well, a lot of it's because as a child, I built this anger and resentment. I want you to pay attention, because when we think about provoking, what comes to mind is an abusive father, right? You may be the nicest guy in the room. You may have never laid a hand on anybody in your life. That don't mean you ain't provoking. My dad is the nicest human I've ever met. He is. My wife's met him. He's the most chilled dude ever. I don't think he's ever been mad. Ever. I'm serious. He does not get mad. Okay, no big deal. I kind of envy it. But because he was the nicest guy in the world, nothing mattered to him, including me. So some of you might go, yeah, I can see how Corey provokes CJ. Remember, you don't necessarily have to be aggressive to provoke. Hang on. So that one's anger, right? We come to Colossians and we see depression and anxiety. Watch this. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger. And so you say, I thought that's the same word. No. Watch the definition. The other one, he's like, listen, it's wrath. Now, this one, it's anger, but he gives you the definition, lest they be discouraged. We call it depression, anxiety. Many a times, as I told you, this thing is generational. Christy and I have spent some time with some people and looking at multiple generations that we're dealing with in these counseling issues, the dad is mad because his dad provoked him. And that dad turned around and his son's full of anxiety, full of it, full of depression. Flips a switch, goes through all kinds of depression. How? It's all provoking. It's just different types of provoking. But even though the dad treated the kids the same way his dad treated him, the kids reacted different. Not every kid is going to get the rage in them. Some kids are just going to get deflated and defeated. And the problem is, when it comes to this thing of provoking, let's look at these seven ways that we do it. Provoking through physical abuse. I think that's the most obvious. You beat on a dog long enough, that dog will come after you. Right? Same way with a kid. Provoking through neglect. That's what happened to me. I became enraged by the nicest guy on the planet. Provoking through physical abuse, psychological abuse. Provoking through failing to understand. That kind of comes back to those words of comfort, those words of understanding. Failing or provoking through too high of expectations. I got to change the word. Yeah, well, it's supposed to be expectations. In other words, what we expect out of our kids. We set the bar up here. Now, guys, this is a balancing act. I do want to set the bar high. I want you to achieve. But setting the bar too high that you can't even achieve, what's the point? Okay? Now, not only that, provoking through reliving their life through them. I've seen this on a baseball field 1,000 times. The dad can't realize, it's not your game anymore, homeboy. I'm sure you were awesome, Al Bundy. All right? No? Provoking through the unacknowledging of mistakes. In other words, when we fail and we don't admit to it. That'll eat away at a kid. And guys, and so we're basically out of time, but man, I'm hoping throughout all this, number one, guys, that we will see the seven responsibilities that we have to make sure that our kids are taken care of. But yet at the same time, I hope throughout this process you've learned your proper understanding of your relationship with God, even though that your relationship with your earthly father may have not been what you wanted. And I'm closing with these words. David Wilkerson was asked in a Q&A, and he said, if you could give any word of advice ever, what would you want to give? If you only have one thing to say to people. Now, this guy is a Bible guy. I mean, he's prayer Jabez guy. I mean, this guy could say a lot. He said, I would tell you to forgive your father. He said, forgive your mother for sure, but definitely forgive your father. And if you can learn anything through this, learn to forgive your father and move on and understand you have a perfect father in heaven. All right, we're out of time. Fellas.